will go ahead and get started for our final lecture, what is condensation. Okay, so where do you come across condensation? So condensation, we have been talking yesterday, Professor Arun taught us about boiling. Now let's worry about condensation. Where does condensation take place? Condensation is there all over the place in power plants. For example, you are talking about condensers in refrigerators, power plants, steam power plants. Water is boiled. If there are condensers, we have seen condensers in refrigerators, we have seen condensers in condensers, we draw condensers in steam power plant. If you see the condensers, for example, if you see the steam power plant, where do I say steam power plant? I have a boiler, and from the boiler I get steam, and from the steam I have a turbine. This is boiler, this is turbine, steam turbine, and from the turbine you get the water coming out, right? Sorry, it is slightly, it is not steam, but it is steam water mixture which is coming out. So now you have to get this through a condenser, and from the condenser you have a small pump. This is condenser, this is the condenser, and this is the pump, and from this pump this is going to the boiler. So what are we worried about? We are worried about the condenser here. This condenser is what we are looking for. What is that which has to get condensed? You see, if I have a mixture, my pump has to handle the mixture of vapor and water, then my pumping work required will become very high if it is two phase. So I want to convert all the left out vapor which is coming out, which is getting out here, condense it thoroughly so that my pump is going to handle only water, only water. That is the reason condenser has been put. So if one has to design the condenser like this, I need to have the idea of the fundamentals of condensers. Okay? Of course, I am not going to go into the details of tube condensers, that is condensation which is occurring on the tube. We will limit our discussion to only on a flat plate. That is, I will take a flat plate which is colder than the steam, that is, I will take a cold flat plate and surrounded by steam, and that steam has to condense on my plate. What will happen to that condensation, at what rate the condensation takes place, and how do I define the Nusselt number, that is the heat transfer coefficient, and how do I handle this under laminar boundary layer case is what I am going to demonstrate today. Tube in tube condensation is pretty involved, that can be taught only in heat exchangers course. Okay? So that cannot be covered in UG heat transfer. Okay. So enthalpy of condensation is very high, and we know that the heat transfer coefficients on the condenser sides are very high. So that is why we are worried about condensation. Okay. There are two types of condensation, one is film condensation and drop condensation. Typically, whatever you see on a Coke bottle which you take out from a refrigerator and keep it outside, what type of condensation you see? Drop wise condensation. You do not see a film, you see a drop wise condensation. But you, this is what is called as I said, there is film wise condensation, and the another case is droplets. There are droplets all over the place, that is you see on a Coke bottle. Which of the two is good, whether film condensation is good or drop wise condensation is good? This is the two things. You see, let us see film. What is a film? What is happening in this condensation? My wall temperature has to be lower than this saturation temperature of the fluid surrounding it. Let me write this so that we do not get lost what we are talking about. We are saying that I have a plate. Okay. You assume this plate temperature as, let us say, T wall equal to 25 degree Celsius, that is, I have taken ambient temperature, and now this is surrounded by steam, let us say. Now let us say there is a steam surrounded around it, and the steam is at atmospheric pressure. Why I am saying atmospheric pressure? Because I need to know the saturation temperature. What is the saturation temperature of steam at atmospheric pressure? 100 degree Celsius. So, I have just saturated steam which is sitting at 100 degrees Celsius. Now, because my wall is cooler than the steam surrounded by it, the steam starts getting condensed on my plate. This condensation can occur in both ways, that is either through film condensation or through drop wise condensation. So, in a film condensation, what is happening? A thin film is being formed. Okay. What is this film made of? This film is made of water, and this film, because it is made of water, it acts as a resistance for the heat transfer now to occur between the plate and the steam. So, film condensation, you can see on the face of it itself, film condensation is not so good compared to, is not so effective compared to drop wise condensation. Drops means there are small films all over the place. Rest of the places where film is not there, then it is all filled with air. So, resistances are less because thermal conductivity of air is lower than the thermal conductivity of water. So, the point is drop wise condensation is more effective than film wise condensation. That is, drop wise condensation is more effective than film wise condensation. That means, h of the film condensation should be greater or lower than the drop wise condensation? Should be higher. Film wise should be lower, drop wise should be higher. This is drop wise and this is film. Is that right? Fine. Now, that is precisely what I am talking here in the these transparencies. There is a blanket, there is a film. The name itself suggests, in one case there is a liquid film being formed, in the other case drops are formed. So, that is why that is called as liquid film, and that is what I am talking about resistance. Here, if the, in case of the film wise condensation, the heat transfer coefficients are generally around 11700 watts per meter square Kelvin. If you remember in the condenser problem yesterday, I took 21800 watts per meter square Kelvin. The heat transfer coefficients in two phase flows are enormously high. So, if you have a film of about 0.05 mm thickness, you get an average heat transfer coefficient of 11700 watts per meter square Kelvin. Now, on the other hand, if it is a drop wise condensation, the heat transfer coefficient can be as high as 30,000 watts per meter square Kelvin. You see almost more than twice. But do we design condensers on the basis of drop wise or film wise condensation? We design our condensers on the basis of film wise condensation. Why? Because it is very difficult to maintain drop wise condensation, because generally nature wants to have film wise condensation. If you want to get a drop wise condensation, you have to apply some paint, you have to maintain the surface texture so that the drop wise condensation is maintained. But whatever texture you maintain, if you have painted, let us say after 6 months the paint vanishes, then eventually the drop wise condensation will turn into film wise condensation. So, it is better to design, even if you imagine that, or even if your texture is maintained, you design the condenser on the basis of film condensation, so that it is a conservative estimate initially, and subsequently film wise condensation will take over. So, that is the sum and substance of the, these two transparencies, what is there here, what all things are written. I would request you to go through this line by line, so that you understand what it is, so that I do not read this. So, the main problem in drop wise condensation is sustainability. There is a word here, sustainability. We cannot sustain drop wise condensation for a long time. Eventually, drop wise condensation transits into film wise condensation because of wettability, because the surface's wettability goes away. Okay. So, Teflon, various things, Teflon coating, if you do, actually you get drop wise condensation, but the coating vanishes. Okay. In fact, there are thousands of patents only on coatings which can maintain drop wise condensation as opposed to film wise condensation. Okay. So, with this let us move on to something concrete, that is laminar film condensation on a vertical wall. What is that I am doing? Okay. So, I am taking a vertical wall. Okay. Unlike you see here, unlike natural convection, in natural convection what was happening, my boundary layer was growing from bottom to top. Notice the difference here. You have the condensation forming from top to bottom. It is very natural. Why? Because it has to fall, is not it? So, initially it is laminar, subsequently it has become wavy. We are not calling it as transition, we are calling it as wavy, and after waviness you get turbulent. So, essentially again you have laminar and turbulent. Okay. So, now what actually happens? This is the wall temperature. What am I doing? Again same conditions, my wall temperature is lower than the reservoir temperature. That is, this reservoir, the wall is kept in, imagine that it is kept in a big room like this where I am sitting, and this full room is filled of steam at atmospheric pressure, and the steam is maintained at a saturation temperature of 100 degree Celsius. If that is the case and my wall temperature is at room temperature, let us say, then condensation starts occurring on the wall. Okay. So, if that is the case, what will happen? Actually, what will happen is, what will happen? Here I have liquid, this is 0, means I am close to the plate. Okay. That is y, x equal to 0 means this is just at the exit of the, just at the plate, edge of the plate. So, now what is happening at any y you take, that is not a problem, that is at any location. Just close to the wall, what is there? Liquid film is there. Subsequent to that, vapor is also there. Okay. But there is an interfacial velocity between liquid and vapor. You see, I have plotted velocity of liquid and vapor. Vapor will have higher velocity compared to that of liquid. While film is flowing, it will entrain the vapor along with it, and it will carry some vapor along with it, and but vapor is going to have a higher velocity. Okay. And next, here you see the temperature. This is the wall temperature, and the temperature in the liquid film is decreasing linearly, although it is not thoroughly linear, we are going to assume linear, and there is vapor temperature difference. What am I going to say? I am going to assume that there is no interfacial shear stress. That means, I am saying that vapor is going to be still, otherwise I need to get the interfacial shear stress. That is why my life becomes very difficult if I take the interfacial shear stress. Under that assumption, what am I going to do? I am going to redraw my figure, and you see here, what have I shown? There is no interfacial shear stress. That means, at the interface between the liquid film and the vapor, I am saying that there is zero shear stress. This is an assumption. How correct is this assumption? My experimental results after computing the heat transfer coefficient will get. We will get that. Okay. So, now this is zero shear stress. There is zero shear stress. And also, I am not taking the temperature gradient which is there in the vapor region. I am taking only in the film region. You see, please note this. There is no interfacial shear stress. This is the crux of the matter actually in this derivation. There is no interfacial shear stress. Actually, vapor wants to move along with the film or even faster than the film, but we are assuming that the vapor surrounded by it is not going to move. Then only, if there is no movement only, then there will be no slip condition at the interface, then the shear stress there would be 0. That is what I am saying. I am assuming no slip condition here, that is interfacial shear stress is 0. Fine. So, now I get T wall, not no slip, sorry, that is not no slip, there is no interfacial shear stress. No slip means u equal to 0, it is not no slip, sorry, it is not no slip, it is just that there is no interfacial shear stress. That means there is no, the vapor is still, not still, vapor is also moving at the same velocity as the liquid film. Actually, vapor is moving faster, but both are moving at the same velocity, when both move at the same velocity, then there can be no shear stress. Okay? So, that is what I am telling. So, here this is the, I am assuming the linear temperature profile. So, if I do that and assume that my complete film is laminar, as usual I am taking that my film is completely laminar. I am not taking that my film is wavy or turbulent, I am only considering laminar portion. If I do that, I have to take the, again I have to take the help of my momentum equations, x momentum equation and energy equation. Energy equation, it is only conduction. Okay? So, within the boundary layer it is only conduction, and that boundary layer, I am assuming within that boundary layer my conduction is 1D. When I said linear, it is only varying with x. Remember my coordinates, let us not forget my coordinates, this is x direction and this is y direction. Okay? U and v, this is y direction, that is moving downwards is considered as positive. Okay. So, if I do that, what will happen to my y momentum equation? Which of the equation is not important? Which velocity is important, u or v? V is important, vertical velocity is important, but the horizontal velocity is not at all important, because it is smaller, it is not that not at all important, it is less important than that of vertical velocity. So, if I neglect the x momentum equation, pressure is going to be a function of only y. So, u is very much less than v, so x momentum equation vanishes and I have y momentum equation. In the y momentum equation also, velocity gradient in the x direction, del squared v by del x squared is important or del squared v by del y squared is important. X is of the order of delta, y is of the order of the flat plate length. So, del squared v by del L squared, this will become, that is v upon L squared, v upon delta squared. So, this is more important than the second term. So, I neglect this. So, then another important term I have kept in the y momentum equation. What is that? What is that equation I have kept in the y momentum equation? What is that I have kept? You please notice that I have kept rho L into g, rho L into g. What is that? Liquid is falling because of the gravity. That body force I have taken rho L into g. Now, tell me what is this dp by dy? Can you tell me what is this dp by dy? That is the pressure impressed on my boundary layer. Liquid film is the boundary layer, impressed on my boundary layer by the atmosphere. Atmosphere is what now? Is atmosphere moving? We said atmosphere is, you have taken it as still. So, that means what? That is hydrostatic pressure minus rho v into g. So, I have taken rho v into g. So, if I substitute that, I get rho L minus rho v into g plus mu L del squared v by del x squared. Is that okay? So, this is my momentum equation. So, if I substitute that in, here, what do I get? In the x, on the left hand side, what do I have? Rho L into u del v by del x plus v del v by del y equal to rho L minus rho v into g plus mu L into del squared v by del x squared. So, what is this? This is inertia. I told, what is inertia? I always remember inertia like this. It is difficult to get up in the morning and come, because we have inertia. Okay? Because we have inertia, I have to take special effort to come. My cycle is standing still, I have to make it moving, means that is cycle is having inertia. I have to give some momentum so that it loses its inertia. So, that is inertia. And what is this? Rho L minus rho V? Sinking effect, sinking effect. More the liquid density, more the body force. Okay? So, this is the sinking effect, and mu L into del squared V by del x squared. Whatever I am teaching now, I am teaching this material from convective heat transfer by Bijan, okay? So, assuming inertia is negligible, but not that it is not there anywhere else, it is there very nicely even in Chengal, even in Incorpora and David. And by the way, whatever we are studying, what is this called? I should not forget that. This is what is called as Nusselt condensation. You see, again Professor Nusselt has made his contribution again in condensation. Okay, this is what we are studying today, is called as Nusselt. It was first derived by Professor Nusselt. Whatever we are deriving now, it was first derived by Professor Nusselt. Okay, so this is my, what do I do? I assume that inertia is negligible. Why do I do this? Because getting the solution of this equation is very difficult. I will simply go ahead and make the inertia negligible, but it is not a valid assumption. I have no reason to tell why inertia can be neglected. By scale analysis, I cannot say that, okay, go ahead and throw the inertia. Because it is difficult to solve, I will go ahead and assume that inertia is negligible. That is right or wrong, only at the end my heat transfer coefficient comparison with the experiments will tell me. Otherwise, I have no reasoning why I should neglect this. So, if I do that, now it is a balance between sinking and friction. Now, what are the boundary conditions? X equal to 0, V equal to 0, X equal to delta, del V by del X equal to 0. If I integrate this equation, I get mu L del V by del X plus G rho L minus rho V into X equal to C 1. And again integrate mu L V plus G into rho L minus rho V X squared by 2 equal to C 1 X plus C 2. I know I am going fast because it is simple mathematics. So, if you substitute X equal to 0, V equal to 0, you get C 2 equal to 0. And if you substitute this boundary condition, you get C 1, that is G into rho L minus rho V into delta. Substituting this C 1 and C 2, I get velocity. Have I got velocity here? Watch carefully this equation. What is this comprising of? It is comprising G rho L minus rho V mu L delta squared X by delta, X by delta squared. Do I know delta? Do I know film thickness? No. Until I find the film thickness, I have not got the velocity. Now, we will go ahead and compute. I do not know the film thickness. That means, I have not reached the answer yet. Taking this velocity, let me start calculating the mass flow rate per unit width. Per unit width means the width of the plate perpendicular to my paper, I am taking it as 1. Later on, I will multiply that with B, which is the width. But for now, that is, instead of taking m dot, I am taking gamma, because gamma represents the mass flow rate per unit width. Okay? Fine. Gamma of y equal to, what is this on the right hand side, which you see? Rho A V. Rho into rho L into V. Instead of area, I have taken x, because it is only varying with x, and I have taken the width as unity, 1. So, 0 to delta rho L V d x is the local mass flow rate. Now, if I substitute the relation for V, which is whole of this equation, and if I integrate this equation, I am going to get, I am not going to do that integration, because all of the steps are very clearly given here, and substitute 0 to delta limits, I get gamma of y, that is the mass flow rate per unit width, equal to rho L into G into rho L minus rho V upon mu L delta cube by 3. I have still not solved the problem, because delta is unknown. Now, we have completed momentum equation. Now, I will take, what is the next equation? Energy equation. But okay, that is this heat transfer, I have multiplied with width B. So, this is the mass flow rate. Okay. So, now remember, if the sinking effect is more, that is, if G into rho L minus rho V is more, means my mass flow rate is high. That is what I understand from this equation. And if the viscosity of the liquid is high, means my mass flow rate, condensation flow rate is less. Okay. So, this is coming out from this equation. Still, we do not know what is delta. Now, heat transfer energy equation is simply d square T by dx squared equal to 0, because I am assuming that it is simple conduction. That means, I am neglecting the convective terms. Okay? That is very important. If I do that, if I integrate that, I get T equal to C 1 x plus C 2. What are the boundary conditions? At x equal to delta, what is the temperature? At x equal to delta, what is the temperature? Saturation temperature, because steam is there. And x equal to 0, wall temperature, I am maintaining constant wall temperature, C 2 equal to T wall. If I substitute these boundary conditions, at any location x, I get T equal to, it is not x, it is, there is a mistake here, it is y, it is not x, is it x? Yeah, it is x, because it is boundary layer is in the x direction, not y, sorry, it is x. T equal to T sat minus T wall into x by delta plus T wall. If I do that, and now what is that I need to substitute? See, I do not think I need to do. If I take that convection equal to conduction in the boundary layer, what is convection defined in two phase, in this case not two phase flow, this is single phase only, h into T sat minus T wall equal to K L into d T by d x at the wall. And do I know d T by d x at the wall? Do I know d T by d x at the wall? That is, I take it as T sat minus T wall upon delta, that is the temperature difference within my film, and that if I equate it to, that is K H equal to minus K L d T by d x at the wall upon T sat minus T wall. This is the definition of H. So, if I substitute that, I get H equal to, what is that H equal to? K L by delta. Is that okay? Did I go fast, Samir, here? It is fine. Gajendra, is that okay? If you have not got, tell me, I will go again. Fine. So, fine. So, now still I have not got the heat transfer coefficient. I have represented, remember, I have represented mass flow rate in terms of delta and heat transfer coefficient in terms of delta. Now, how do I get this delta? I have to invoke sensible heat equal to latent heat of condensation. I have not invoked that condition yet. Okay? That is, I am just doing this, let me finish off that and invoke. See, this is my mass flow rate. Now, I need this d m dot by d y little later, that is why I am writing this and keeping. If I differentiate this, what do I get? B, rho L, g, all of this are constant, only delta is a function of y. My film thickness is a function of y. If I differentiate this, I get 3 delta squared by 3 d delta by y. This is the rate of condensation with respect to y. Now, what do I do? What is the condition I am invoking? Rate of heat transfer from the vapor to the plate through the liquid film is equal to heat released as the vapor is condensed. Is that right? Vapor condensation rate has to be equal to the rate of the heat transfer gained by my plate through conduction or convection, is not it? So, d m dot h of g is equal to K L into area, that is B into d y into T sat minus T wall upon delta. Is that okay? So, if I do that, d m dot by d y, if this d y if I pull out, I get d m dot by d y. I have just now derived what is d m dot by d y in terms of d delta by d y. If I substitute that, what am I doing? What am I trying to do in this problem? Let us stop and think. What am I trying to do? I want to find the heat transfer coefficient and the rate of condensation and the boundary layer thickness. Okay? So, I get, if I substitute for that d m dot by d y here, whatever equation I have got into all of this. So, if I equate this, and now what is that I should do? I now get delta cube equal to d delta into all of this. What can I do next? What is that? I have to integrate this. If I integrate this, I get delta to the power of 4 and all of this as a function of y. What is delta at y equal to 0? It is 0. So, I get c equal to 0. So, I get delta. I get a very nice equation for delta. Do I know everything on the right hand side of this delta? Mu L, I know. K L, thermal conductivity, I know. T sat, I know. T wall, I know. Rho L, I know. G, I know. Rho V, I know. H of G, I know. Now, film thickness, I have found very nicely in terms of thermophysical properties and temperatures. Okay. If I get delta, I have written already equations for mass condensation rate and H in terms of delta. If I substitute this delta, there I am going to get the condensation rate and the heat transfer coefficient. I said h equal to K L by delta. If I substitute that, delta here, and I am integrating this for complete length. Why? Because I want to get the average heat transfer coefficient. Integrating 0 to L y to the power of minus 1 by 4 upon 1 by L, because all of this is constant, they are not varying with y. So, if I do that, I get average heat transfer coefficient equal to 0.943 into all of this. Okay. Similarly, condensation rate equal to all of this into delta Q by 3. I get mass flow rate equal to all of this. Okay. If I again rearrange this, I get this. Now, the only question is that at what temperature I should be computing all these properties. It is but natural that I have to take it at film temperature. Film average film temperature is T wall plus T sat by 2. That is precisely what is written here. T film equal to T sat plus T wall by 2. Now, I took in all of this analysis, let me just take a recap of what I have done. What did we do? We assumed that my boundary layer is, my film is laminar. I should not be using the word boundary layer, although boundary layer concepts are what we are using. My film is laminar, that is number 1. Number 2, this steam which is around it, I am assumed it as saturated, number 2. And number 3, what is the assumption I have made? There is no interfacial shear stress between the vapor and the liquid film which is there. Under these assumptions, I invoked the momentum equation, and in the momentum equation, x momentum equation we threw because u is very much lower than x, and I invoked only the y momentum equation, and I invoked y momentum equation, threw this apart and substituted for dp by dy rho v into g, and I get 3 forces which are very important: inertia force, sinking effect and friction. Okay. And applied the boundary conditions, and I got the velocity profile in terms of delta. Next, I assumed that only, of course, this is mass flow rate, that is the mass condensation rate, and I assumed that it is conduction which is happening within my film, not convection terms are not so important, I have assumed. And then I got the heat transfer coefficient in terms of film thickness, and invoking that latent heat, that is the condensation which is occurring because of the latent heat, is equal to heat conducted or the heat convected within my boundary layer. That is, heat transfer from vapor to the plate through liquid film by convection is equal to heat released as the vapor is condensed. That is m dot hfg, d m dot hfg equal to this conduction within the boundary layer. If I put that, I get the boundary layer film thickness. That film thickness, if I substitute in h, I get the heat transfer coefficient. Okay. From this heat transfer coefficient, I can even plot Nusselt number, that is not an issue, and from that I get condensation rate. So, there are 2 unknowns in this problem. Usually film velocity is known, I mean in a flow, in our boundary layer problems, velocity is known, free stream velocity. Here nothing is known like that, because condensation rate is not known, that is unknown, and heat transfer coefficient is unknown, both we have found. If there is subcooling, that is if my steam is, or if my wall temperature, what is this subcooling? What is this subcooling? My wall temperature is much lower than the saturation temperature. To take into account of this subcooling, I have, people have given just a correction factor, okay? That is 0.68 CPL into T sat minus T wall. Okay? So, they have given, which we had not considered earlier, that is sensible heat we had not considered, is not it? There is latent heat, you see in our assumption we just took the latent heat, but there is actually, there is sensible heat also between the wall and the fluid. Okay? So, that sensible heat is considered in terms of 0.68 CPL T sat minus T wall. If you take that, who gave this 0.68? 0.68 came through analytical calculations and experiments. So, we will have to present that as corrected HFG prime. Instead of taking HFG, you better take it as HFG prime. Just HFG, instead of just HFG, you take subcooled portion also, but that subcooled portion, you multiply this 0.68 and you take that as corrected latent heat, then it works well in the same relation which we derived in the above case. That is, same relation is valid, same relation is valid, only instead of HFG, you will have to take HFG prime. That is what Nusselt said. And then we said there is a Jacob number, that is CPL into sensible upon latent is defined as what is called as Jacob number HFG prime equal to HFG into 1 plus 0.68 Jacob number you are going to get. That is, that is just an introduction how to tell what is the amount. Jacob number represents sensible heat upon latent heat, nothing great or nothing physically coming out from that. Now, if someone wants it, we can even define what is called as Reynolds number, because we are all very much concerned about, we represents all flow in terms of Reynolds number. So, to take into account of that fact, we define Reynolds number equal to rho um dh upon mu l. What is dh? That is hydraulic diameter. Let us see. If I take a plate, perimeter is L, area is L into delta, because neglecting this small portion, I have taken only L. So, hydraulic diameter equal to 4 a by p, you get 4 delta. The point is, in all cases, you are going to get this as 4 delta only, whether you take a cylinder horizontal, cylinder vertical, cylinder horizontal, you take a vertical plate, you are going to get this as 4 delta. Okay? So, I am not going to tell you exactly why p equal to L I have taken and A I have taken L into delta, you figure it out yourself and you will understand what I am talking about. Okay. So, you get, if I substitute that as hydraulic diameter and from mass flow rate, if I substitute um for um, I am going to get Reynolds number as 4 g delta cube by 3 nu l squared. But still delta, if you know delta, if you substitute that delta, you will get the Re, because we have now got delta already. Okay. So, now H average can also be represented in terms of Reynolds number, 1.47 kl Re to the power of minus 1 by 3 g upon nu l squared to the power of 1 by 3. Okay. So, now that is about laminar. Now, we have to worry about wavy and also turbulent. For wavy, people have done experiments and they have found that this is how Kututlat J way back in 1963 has, it is sort of semi empirical, he has done this and find that heat transfer in wavy channel is going to be something like this, that is Re K L upon 1.08 Re to the power of 1.22 minus 5.2 into g by nu L, this is kinematic viscosity, nu L square to the power of 1 by 3. Okay? Now, when does flow become wavy? That is the question I have not answered yet. Okay? When the Reynolds number is greater than 30, what is my Reynolds number definition now? Reynolds number equal to 4 rho L squared g delta cube by 3 mu L squared, and R e equal to, if you substitute the delta for vertical plate in terms of the heat transfer coefficient, you can get. Let me not put that way. You know delta already in terms of thermophysical properties and wall temperature difference. If you know that, you can compute the Reynolds number. Can I say that? Yes. Okay. So, that is what I have done here. So, for all Reynolds numbers less than 30, my flow is laminar. Greater than 30, it is wavy. Now, this is the equation which is valid both for, this is the equation which is suggested by Chen. It is not only I will, yeah, this is suggested by Chen, other equation. This was Kututlat's and this is Chen's correlation. I have forgotten to write that this is Chen. This is Chen's correlation. Now, for turbulent flow, Labutsnow has given the correlation. These correlations I have taken from Bejan, as I said. Reynolds number greater than 1800, between 30 and 1800, we have wavy film. So, above 1800, I have turbulent. And again, you can see that it is a function of Reynolds number and g by nu L squared. Okay? So, that is what you get. And if it is inclined, all that you need to do is inclined equal to h vertical into cos theta. What is this equation? This equation is valid both for wavy and turbulent. I have forgotten to write here again. This equation is valid for both. Let me write this so that we do not go too fast, and let us solve a problem. That is, I am going to write only this equation, HL into HL bar by KL, HL bar by KL, that is average heat transfer coefficient upon thermal conductivity of liquid into nu L squared by G, nu L squared by G to the power of 1 by 3 equal to Reynolds number to the power of minus 0.44, R E L to the power of minus 0.44 plus 5.82 into 10 to the power of minus 6, 5.22 into 10 to the power of minus 6 R E L to the power of 0.88 P R to the power of 1 by 3 whole to the power of half. Okay? So, that is the correlation for both wavy and turbulent. That means it is going to cover what all domains? Reynolds number equal to 80 to whatever number, greater than 80. It is Reynolds number greater than 30, that is not 80, anything greater than 30. Let me rewrite this. Reynolds number greater than 30, this equation is valid. Okay? Let us see, there is one interesting graph here. Let us spend time on that graph, and then we will move on to a problem, which is an interesting problem again. This is, you see here, this is heat transfer coefficient into nu L squared by G to the power of 1 by 3 upon K L. Actually, very interesting here. Why I say interesting? Because nu L squared by G, all of you sit down and get me the unit of nu L squared by G to the power of 1 by 3. What is nu L squared by G to the power of 1 by 3. Samir says that he gets nu L squared by G to the power of 1 by 3, he is getting meter. Let us see, do we get meter or not. Nu L squared by G to the power of 1 by 3. What is nu? What is the unit of nu? Meter squared per second. That is meter squared per second whole squared upon what is the unit of G? Meters per second squared to the power of 1 by 3. So, what do I get? Meter to the power of 4 upon meter into what is this I get? Second squared upon second squared to the power of 1 by 3. Second squared get cancelled out. I get meter cube to the power of 1 by 3. That means meter to the power of 3 by 3, that is meter. Okay? So, that means it is so ingenious. You see, what is the unit I have taken here? H L by K, that is Nusselt number. That is Nusselt number. Nu L squared by G to the power of 1 by 3, that is how the Nusselt number has been chosen, and this is Reynolds number. So, you can see that until laminar case, wavy. For Reynolds number 30, this dashed line is the heat transfer coefficient computed using the laminar derivation whatever we did. So, that is what it is, and from here to here it is wavy laminar 30 to 1800. Subsequent to that it is different for different Prandtl numbers. Okay? So, that is what we found, and quickly within 5 minutes we shall solve a problem. Okay. So, we have saturated steam at atmospheric pressure condenses on a 2 meter high and 3 meter wide vertical plate. It's and that is maintained at 80 degree Celsius by circulating cooling water through the other side. Determine the rate of heat transfer by condensation to the plate and the rate at which the condensate drips off the plate at the bottom. Okay? Very interesting problem. Okay? So, if you take T sat and T wall 180 divided by 2, I get film temperature as 90. At this film temperature, if I take all the properties of the liquid and calculate HFG prime, I get 2314 into 10 to the power of 3 joule per kg. Now, I substitute. Now, question is, do I know whether it is laminar or turbulent? I do not know. What is the way out? First, I will calculate heat transfer coefficient. Why? Because my Reynolds number is dependent. I can calculate Reynolds number only after I calculate the condensation rate. I can calculate condensation rate only after I get the heat transfer coefficient. Is that right? Let me do. Let me go slow here. It is quite, we have to think a little bit what we are doing. I will go ahead and assume that my flow is laminar. That is, my film is laminar. If I do that and this relation whatever I have derived, this is for laminar case. If I substitute all thermophysical properties and the temperatures, I am going to get HL bar as 2656.2 watt per meter squared Kelvin. Now, I need to calculate the condensation rate. I do not have to remember any relation which I derived very easily. Q dot equal to m dot HSF, HFG. So, Q dot equal to HL AS into T sat minus T wall, that gives me so much load. This is my load. Heat transfer rate. Heat transfer rate equal to m dot into HFG. Please do not take it as HSF, HFG. If it is HFG, I get m dot equal to 0.1329 kg per second. So, Reynolds number equal to 4 into m dot by b mu l. This is what we have defined, 4 gamma upon mu l. Okay? So, now I get Reynolds number as 562.5. What is this suggesting? I am in wavy. For wavy and turbulent, I have already got a relation which I wrote just now on my whiteboard. This is the relation we wrote. So, that relation if I put, I am going to get a heat transfer coefficient of 7691.4 and from that I get the heat transfer rate and from that I get the condensation rate and from that I get the Reynolds number which is 4221. Now, I know for sure that my condensation is actually decided that it is turbulent. It is neither wavy nor laminar. So, the Reynolds, this Reynolds number confirms that condensation is wavy laminar domain. So, this is about condensation and full credit, I mean whatever we have learned, it is all because of the hard work of Professor Nusselt. This is what is called as Nusselt condensation. You see Nusselt is there everywhere. Okay. Throughout convection, Professor Nusselt is there. Okay. Without his efforts, there could not have been convective heat transfer. That is why appropriately we have given Nusselt number, because we do not want to forget him anywhere. Okay. So, with this, we are saying that we are stopping condensation. We are not saying that we have completed condensation. We are stopping condensation simply because we have not covered tube in tube condensation. I am sure there will be a question, what will happen in case of tube in tube condensation. Tube in tube condensation, again Nusselt number will be dependent on Dittus-Boelter correlation, but the other parameter which comes into effect is the thermodynamic quality. Nu by Nu naught equal to a function of quality, that is what is called as Schaas correlation. So, let us not worry about all of that. I think I want to spend just one more minute, 5 more minutes on the natural convection experiment, because there were so many questions whether I should be taking thickness or not. Samir has gone ahead and did that calculation. So, we get some interesting results. What is interesting? Let us see. Okay. So, we said that, let me just take the natural convection case. See, in the natural convection, what did we see? We melted, the ice got melted and we latent heat was taken equal to convection, and what was the condensation rate I am supposed to take? Somewhere around 3, because this is where, somewhere around 3, because this is where it is reaching steady state. Now, if I take, and question was, always the question was, I have an ice block like this. I have an ice block like this, and boundary layer is being formed on both. What about the boundary layer formed on the side walls? Why are you not taking into account? You are very right. Samir has gone ahead and done that. I will quickly do that. It won't take much time, not more than 2 minutes. M dot equal to, I have already posted this in Moodle, but still, 3 into 10 to the power of minus 5 kg per second, Q dot equal to M dot HSF this time, that is 331.4 into 3 into 10 to the power of minus 5, I get 10 watts, this is already there. Radiation loss, I had taken only the area, that is equal to sigma a T infinity to the power of 4 minus T s to the power of 4. T infinity, that is sigma is 5.67 into 10 to the power of minus 8 into area. I had taken earlier 2 into height 0.16 into width 0.105. Now, I have to take thickness also into account, that is plus 2 into height 0.16 into thickness is 0.01 into temperature, that is 298 to the power of 4 minus 273 to the power of 4. I get 4.865 watts. Earlier my radiation loss was, what was my radiation loss? Yeah, I just want to show them. Radiation loss was earlier 4.44. Now my radiation loss has gone up to 4.865 watts. Now, let me compute convective heat transfer coefficient. That is, now Q equal to, Q actual equal to 10 minus 4.865 watts, I get 5.135 watts. So, Q dot actual equal to H into area into T wall minus, sorry, T infinity minus T wall. What is Q dot actual? 5.135, H I do not know, area is again same, 2 into 0.16 into 0.105, remember we had just taken this area, I had not taken the side area, that is thickness, plus 2 into 0.16 into 0.01, this is the 10 mm thickness, 0.01 into 298 minus 273, I get H equal to 5.584 watts per meter squared Kelvin. What is the Nusselt number? I get 35.7. Okay, let us remember that. I am getting a Nusselt number of 35.7. Now, Nusselt experimental 35.7. Nusselt correlation 1, which was stated earlier, is 33. Now, if I take nu equal to 0.59 RAH to the power of minus 1 by 4, if I substitute that, I am going to get it as, what is that I get? 34.8. Now, what has happened? You see, one of the participants, thanks to him, he has corrected my numbers. He has corrected my numbers. That is, experimental I am getting 35.7. One correlation is giving me 33, another correlation is giving me 34.8. Beautiful, isn't it? It is a simple experiment. Just taking rupees 200, we are able to demonstrate natural convection heat transfer coefficient. I want to take an example of Professor C. V. Raman's. C. V. Raman's Nobel Prize experiment took not more than 100 rupees. The point is, if you want to demonstrate something, you do not need money. All that you need is the thought process, okay. If you think properly and if you design your experiment properly, you can demonstrate very nicely the fundamental principles. That is the point I want to make. But still, we should not be very excited that my reading is very much matching. We should keep in the back of our minds, this 33 is having at least plus or minus 10%. That means, this is 33 plus or minus 3.3. And this is 34.8 plus or minus 3.5, and this is 35.7 plus or minus 3.6. This is there in the back of our mind. This only we are excited because this, if I add 33 plus 3.3, I get 36.3. So, my 35.7 is within that 36.3. Again, 34.8 plus 3.5 is again within the band of 35.6. All that I am saying is my number is within that band, within that uncertainty band. That is all I am saying. So, that is the, so thanks to the participant, this is the greatness of discussion. This is because we discussed and we calibrated ourselves. That is what we learn through observation. Had we not done the observation, this much discussion would not have occurred. So, that is the greatness of experiments. If you do experiments, we get observations. If you observe something, you tend to question that and try to understand that. Okay? That is the essence of experiments. With this, I think we are through with the teaching session. We will open. Okay. So, Professor Arun is suggesting that 2-3 centers had missed the experimental portion, 2 experiments which I had told. He says that before we break for, not break, we transit into question answer session, let us quickly go through those 2 experiments. Yes, that is what I had, we had promised also. Yes, we will take 5 to 7 minutes. If you further have any questions in spite of my presentation, you please come back on the Moodle with questions. So, now let me open that. Okay, this is little involved. First let me take easier one and then go to the little tougher one. Okay, so now unsteady heat conduction in a sphere. See, why I have designed this experiment and why we are even proposing in our lab in IIT this, because all experiments what we interfaced when with our coordinators, we learned that most of the experiments what we are doing are all steady state experiments, they are not transient. To drive home the transient conduction problem, we have designed this problem. Again, I have taken this experiment from the book which I suggested yesterday, Professor Granger's book. Okay? This is not my experiment, this is Professor Granger's experiment. Not Professor Granger, I do not recollect which professor has suggested, one of the professors has suggested and has been written in Granger's book. The same thing I have put, if you want details, you can go back to that book and read this. What I am doing is, I am taking a small sphere made of any insulating material, or it can be copper also. When to go for copper and when to go for insulating material, I will tell little while from now. You put a thermocouple, you take a sphere, what is that I need is just that you make a sphere or a cylinder, either of the two. I am pertaining my explanation with reference to sphere with perspex or Teflon, let us say, and I put a thermocouple and take it out. Now, I take this sphere and put it in a hot water bath. Now, my sphere will start picking up temperature. Now, I have measured, what is the temperature I have measured? Temperature versus time. Okay? Now, we have done this. What is this? This is under, I have put it in a hot water bath. Analysis we have done for this. Remember, this is not lumped. This is not lumped. I am taking that this is one dimensional conduction. So, why have I put at the center? Because I am tracking the center line temperature T naught, if you remember the definition. So, T naught minus theta naught, that is T naught minus T infinity equal to, let me write that, T naught minus T infinity upon T I minus T infinity equal to E to the power of, you remember the relation, E to the power of minus lambda 1 squared tau, minus lambda 1 squared tau. What is tau? E to the power of minus lambda 1 squared tau is Fourier number, that is alpha t, lambda 1 squared alpha t, a 1 will be there for minus lambda 1 squared alpha t by r naught squared, r naught squared. Is that right? So, now if I take T naught is the temperature as I am marching with time, T I is the initial temperature, this is the fluid temperature. A 1 is here, yes, he is right, A 1 is here. Okay? So, now if I plot, what do? If I plot this, What am I doing? Let me just take stock. It is, yeah, A1 is there. If I plot this, if I take log of this, log of T naught minus T infinity upon T I minus T infinity equal to, what will I get? Log of A1 minus of lambda 1 squared alpha T by R naught squared. What is this of the form? This is Y, this is C, and this is my M. Y equal to minus, this is X, minus MX plus C. If I plot that, it is going to be something like this. Okay. So, what is this? What is this constant? What is this I get? What is this? That is nothing but my C. When X equal to 0, that is when T equal to 0, whatever Y I get, this is not directly right. I am, this is log of, this is what I measure. I have to plot one more plot, wherein which I plot log of this, let me call this as theta, log of theta versus T. Then whatever plot I get, it is going to be linear, and this is not right. This is nothing but my log of A1, which is constant. From this, what do I get? A1 I get. If I go to my table, if I go to my table, I have to open transient conduction. No chance. There is no other option for me. If I go to transient conduction, let me go to the table. Yes. Is this? No. Is this? Yes. So, now thanks to zooming concept, now now let me focus only on cylinder. Okay. So, now what do I get? Sphere, or we can do for cylinder also. For a sphere, what do I get? This is my constant A1 I have got. Having got A1, if I get A1, I can get my, for a given A1, there is one unique lambda 1 and Biot number. So, if I put that back here, I get lambda 1 and I get Biot number. If I get lambda 1, what is that slope? Slope is equal to lambda 1 squared alpha by R naught squared. I know my M, because from this curve I get the slope, and I get lambda 1 from the table. I know R naught squared. I can calculate thermal diffusivity of my material. Beautiful, isn't it? So, that is what it is, the demonstration. Now, I said I will come back which material you are going to choose. If you say that, oh, I need data logger to get the temperature measurement transient I need. No, not really, I do not agree with you. Why? Because if you take perspex, it is going to respond very slow. You can take with the multimeter also, there is no problem. If you take perspex or Teflon or any insulating medium, you make a sphere with that insulating medium, there is no problem. If you have a data logger, you are a rich person, data cards are available even for 25 and 30,000 rupees, Indian make Dynalog data cards. So, if you purchase them, it is not going, if then you can do with copper also, then you can do with copper also. Then there is an interesting thing, if you take copper, if you take copper, you can make it lumped also. If you make lumped, then you can get direct, then it takes a different note. Okay. So, you take, it cannot become lumped if you take a bigger copper cylinder. Okay. So, point is, there are multi facets for a given experiment. It is not just one way of doing things. If you start making, building an experiment and start doing experiment, definitely you are going to get infinite ideas, not only from yourself, from your students also, when they ask questions, why not do this, why not do that. Definitely it will just open several windows for thought process. Okay. So, that is one of the experiments, and then the next experiment is this. I am going to zip and really fast. Okay. So, actually what it is this gives thermal conductivity and thermal diffusivity in one shot, but this is little involved, it is not that straightforward, but still we can build it. It is not at all, when I say involved, it is not impossible, it is little difficult, that is all. What we are saying is that I have an insulating medium, let us say, which is filled here, it can be liquid also actually. I have a wire, heater wire, which is put here, and there is a thermocouple embedded at different location. If I apply heat, that is this Q, if I track this temperature of the thermocouple at a presented at a different location, I get the temperature distribution as T minus T naught equal to Q 1 upon 4 pi k log T plus log of 4 alpha by R squared minus 0.5772. So, if I plot this again and do the, this is the equation I get. I have not derived, I said this derivation is in Karla and Jaeger. This is a line source what is applied. Okay. If I have a line source and this is the temperature distribution, I can again apply y equal to mx plus c funda and get both k and alpha. With this input, I am going, I think I know I have not done justice to this experiment, but still I have given the glimpse of it, how do we attack it. Okay. So, with this we will take up questions. So, Professor Arun will keep starting taking questions. I will just come back in a minute.